So thank you for the invitation to come here. Yes, now it should be working. I hope I am understandable. You will see a lot of pictures on these slides which you presumably can't read. But don't bother, I'll leave the slides and then you can put them on your own computer and take a viewer and enlarge them, and then you can only see the very details of what you are going to see. I hope I can operate this sort of devices. I hope to do it for my own computer, but technology evidently is too complicated. The essential thing you see on this opening slide is already the essential message I want to get across here. And that message is that there is no such thing as a Van Emmon-Bowles tree. There are actually two different versions. One is, which is reasonably simple, and another one which is very complicated. And the main issue I will be talking about is what were the historical circumstances which have lured me to have spent 4 years of my life in the period of 74 until 78 working on this very complicated structure while the more simple one virtually remained untouched until Don Kluge started writing classroom notes about it. It has all to do with the way this area of computer science is developed. The interesting thing is that I realized that Nikos yesterday in his talk about algorithm engineering basically was going back to the very same period of the early 70s. In this talk, I have not seen all the direct links, but you can see it from this presentation here or the presentation of the proceedings. But if you go back to my very first report where I first developed these stratified trees, it's even far more closer to the kind of topics Nikos was talking about than the general perspective about stratified trees today. Let's see if I can operate this. First, give a rather short historical introduction how I came to Cornell at all, to these sort of works and what went before it. Then I'll tell you what the problem area is. The problem is which these stratified trees are supposed to be solving. I will try to give you the intuition between the two approaches for solving this problem, which I call now the binary search and level approach and the cluster galaxy decomposition. The binary search of levels is the hard one, the cluster galaxy decomposition is the more naive intuitive direct one. Then we get to the fundamental problem having to do with machine learning, which basically made it impossible for me to work out details of the cluster galaxy decomposition around 74. It's a completely crazy problem which nobody today takes serious, but at that time I simply was told not to do particular things. I try to give some high-level perspective about these complications of the working out the binary search of level things, which basically will show you just the ingredients which are there. If you want really to know how that thing works, I think still the best solution is go back to this 1977 paper, because it's all explained there. And since nothing has changed to it, essentially, I think that's still the best place to look for it. I will tell you how the thing was developed, a little bit about the impact, applications, improvements, and global bouncing, also organizations. And that's it. I'm not even sure how far I can get in this whole list of topics. So let me first tell you how I came in Cornell in 74. Starting 64, I started my academic career as a researcher. I had been studying 2 years before already in mathematics. But in 64, I was invited to become a sort of technical research assistant at the Mathematicentrum in Amsterdam, which now is called the Center of Mathematics and Computer Science. So as a third year student, I started to do research. From that period, I just want to highlight one of my achievements, which actually was my first international contribution at a conference. And that conference actually was held in this part of the world, in Herzegovina, in Montenegro. I'm not sure whether you realize that this is why this is my second trip to the area. It's a paper in Satiratical Topology. You cannot see it on the screen, but this was the main theorem I proved there. Theorem stated in seven words, rather simple. It deals with the fundamental definitional mechanisms of satiratical topology. As my colleagues experienced it at that time, it's a completely counterintuitive and unexpected result, but it's also completely useless, since to my knowledge, this result has never found any application in theoretical topology at all. At least that was the status 3 years ago when I gave my valedictory address and one of my topology colleagues was one of the speakers. And he told me there are still no applications of it, but it's a beauty. Then, in order to see what we were looking like at that time, that's me, in 68. That's the car we drove to Yugoslavia. You see my beautiful wife with a headscarf behind the wheel of the car. These pictures, by the way, all were taken in Italy. But these two should show you that we really made it to Montenegro. Then in 71, I had this opportunity of making a short visit to the US. And by the time I had decided I want to broaden my perspective, let's not visit the mathematicians, let's pay a visit to the growing field of computer scientists. Now, the closest university to Endicott, where my wife was working, which was the reason for visiting the US at all, turned out to be Cornell. And at Cornell, I met this guy, Joris Hartmanis. That's a picture from the early 70s. He is original from Latvia, but during the war, after a lot of tribulations, he had emigrated to the US, worked for a large period at General Electric in Rensselaer, and eventually became instrumental in founding the computer science department at Cornell University. He is a theoretician who was rather essential in setting up the foundations of complexity theory as we know it today, and he was awarded the Turing Award for that, together with his colleagues, Richard Stearns, the two authors of the first seminal paper on complexity of Turing machines. This is what the Cornell campus was looking like in these days. Here in the picture. Up some hall, the Department of Computer Science building, the way it looked like in 73 and the way it looked like last year when I was paying a visit there. Actually, this year the computer science is moving to another building, founded by the Gates Foundation. Funded by the Gates Foundation. The impact of the acquisitions was that I switched completely from pure mathematics to theoretical computer science. So I wrote a thesis on the, at that time, the subject of abstract complexity theory, which is basically something of the interface between theoretical computer science and classical recursion theory. If you have never attended a PhD ceremony in the Netherlands, let me just show you what it looks like. It's a real ceremonial formal address where you are dressed up and you're defending your thesis for 45 minutes against the committee, all dressed up as well. Now that is part of the committee which wasn't active. I'm facing the people on the bench who are asking me difficult questions. On the right side you see my wife here present, the other guy is Professor Hendrik Lenstra, who eventually became a very famous mathematician in number theory. Professor Hartmanis was one of the advisors of my thesis, the only one who really understood it. I had two formal advisors, Professor Baye, who was my chief at the Mathematics Center, and Professor Aas van Berngaarde, who is more in numerical mathematics, numerical algorithms, but he is also the chief designer of the language model 68. And this is the cover of my thesis. Remember the aerial picture? That's what's on it. But it's hard to recognize it unless you go from a larger distance, as Julius Hartmanis has discovered. After my thesis, I went back to Cornell, and there I interacted with people like John Lovecraft, who see here, waving his hand, and some problem about the evaluation of polynomials. This was my roommate, Wolfgang Paul, who at that time of his development was working to break the improve the two and lower bound for general circuits. That's still a part unsolved problem to my knowledge. I think 4 and is still the optimal bound achieved today, which only means a doubling in 40 years of work. Jan Simon and Zvi Galil are also two people which have become far more important since, but then at that time they were co-students at Cornell. And that's what I looked like myself during the period. This is a very important picture. Do you know why? It's the last picture taken of me where I'm not having my beard. What I was supposed to be studying there was to get myself introduced in the field of analysis of order. This book had just appeared. It covered all this nice material about computing dominators and graphs we heard about yesterday, be it that they had not yet obtained by the time the book was written the optimal results. For example, it has the Union find algorithm written one star bound rather than the inverse Ackermann function, simply because that result was more or less achieved in the same period the book was written. These are the two other co-authors we have already seen up of. These are AO and Odomat. The pictures are slightly 7 years after the book had appeared, but this was going to appear in my picture collection. I had support from the Dutch National Science Foundation just to get introduce myself to this field and to take it back to Holland and train people about it. But while reading the book, I immediately stumbled on an area which was quite interesting to look at, and that was the theory of data structures. Now, what sort of data structures I'm talking about? The general idea is that frequently in algorithms you are manipulating some set of objects. And those objects have to be identified somehow and technical way to do so is to use numerical keys. These numerical keys are drawn from some set of numbers, not the whole set, but a subset of it, the contiguous subset, which we will call the universe. The universe has some size, that's the number of potential key values you have available, but in general, you're not going to use all the key values at the same time. You use a subset which may be much smaller. So U is the size of the universe and N is the set of elements we're going to manipulate. The natural ordering of the on the universe is frequently important. Well, this is one of the things which has to become garbled due to response size. Should be nice stable. It are the instructions you want to execute. So insert will typically add an element. Delete will remove an element. Member will test whether this particular argument is in the set or not. Cardinality will tell you how many elements there are. Order for those four instructions is not relevant. But then there are instructions like min and max, which gives you the smallest and the largest element. Successor of x, that can be two things. If x is present, it's just the next element in the order. If x is not present, it's the first element which belongs to the set larger than x. Predecessor is similar in the opposite direction, and then there is a final instruction, neighbor, which only makes sense if you add all the universal additional structure. You will encounter it in the future, but it's either the predecessor or the successor, but which of the two depends basically on the binary representation of those numbers. It's the one who has the most corresponding bits in the binary representation. Why that's meaningful, you will see. Then you have also composed instructions, so you can isolate the minimal element and remove it from the set, that's the extract min, the same with the maximum, or take some point and remove from the set all the elements which are smaller. So all min is an instruction which will manipulate the number of sets, which is relevant for estimating the complexity of it. Now, if you're not talking about order, these instructions are all very simple to implement. You just use bit string on an array structure and you can address every element directly within unit time, as long as you're using uniform time measure. So that covers inserting, deleting, member and cardinality. If you're only interested in looking at the order structure, you can use a list data structure, a W-linked list, if you want to move in both directions, and that will make some of the order instructions very simple. But then it's hard to insert and remove elements if you don't know where they are located in the list. So some things can be done in unit time, but other problems will become really hard. In the worst case, it may take size proportional to the size of the set, the size of the set you are manipulating, so it becomes order n. Data structures are developed for compromising between those two complexities. And what you typically will experience if you look at binary search trees or heaps or B trees or two tree trees or AVL trees or any of those other structures which you can find in the literature, they achieve all instructions with a processing time of order log n in the uniform time measure. Now, frequently you are not interested in having all the instructions at the same time, so a very characteristic example is the example of a priority queue. That's some data structure designed to implement insert and extract min. If you have those two instructions, that suffices, for example, to use a priority queue for sorting an arbitrary bag of elements. You can do so using leaves or bee trees or any of those structures, and you will typically realize that you have a processing time of order n log n in the uniform time measure. Now, that seems perfectly reasonable because we have a matching load bound for the complexity of sorting. That's the so-called famous information theoretical lower bound that tells you you need order n log n comparison-based instructions. Now, here is the catch. The lower bound speaks about the lower bound in the comparison-based model. But in the random access machine, you use direct access. So in principle, it should be possible to beat that lower bound by using the power of direct access. And that's what the literature shows you. If you have just a small universe, then you can use algorithms like radix sort or bucket sort and sort in bag of elements in linear time. Now, it works if the universe size is equal to the set size, or it also works in case for radix sort if you have a constant power of the universe size. But this is only for sorting. What about the full instruction repertoire? And that was the problem I started working on. And the result was that I developed these so-called stratified trees, which only became known as Van den Bos trees much later. It's, by the way, a mystery how this name appeared in the literature. It implements the full instruction repertoire with a processing time of order log log u. Whether that's optimal, that's an interesting question, but there are positive answers to that effect, and you'll see them at the end of the talk. Is it really better than the binary search tree based structures? That depends on the size of your set compared to the size of the universe. If n is really small, so you're having a very sparse set, n proportional to the logarithm of n or just the polynomial power of that, then the binary search structures are completely competitive. But if you really are using a substantial part of the universe in your set, then it becomes better. So how did we break this log n bound? Let me first tell you about a simple idea, that's one of the pictures you see, which simply attains the log u bound, but gives a clue on how to improve on it. We take the universe and we place it at the leaves of a huge binary tree. And when we insert an element, we mark that leaf and we mark all the nodes on the path between the leaf and the root. And I claim that this is a useful structure for performing operations because they now can be performed simply by going to an argument, look at its corresponding leaf, and start walking upwards until something interesting happens. What is something interesting? Well, it depends on whether the element you're starting off is present or not. If it's not present, it's simply the first marked node you encounter. If it is present, it's the first node having two marked sides. In the second case, you can call it the branch point. In the first place, I'm going to call it the focal point. Definitions you find below. So, how, for example, do you evaluate the minimum? You simply walk down from the root the leftmost marked path, and you will arrive at the minimum automatically. But there is an easier way, but preferably simply store the mineral at the root and you maintain it during the manipulations of the set. Then you can access the mineral in constant time. Another perspective is always add the limit based on the leaves. You will do that anyhow. Member, you can simply directly access the leaf and see whether it's marked or not. Insert, you go to the leaf and you perform such an upward walk. Delete, you walk upwards, unmarking on the note until you get the red joint. So these are all actions proportional to the height of the tree in time complexity, and that means a processing time or log U. Now you see what is the origin of this neighbor instruction. You walk upwards until you find the focal or branch point, and then you walk downwards along the alternate path, always trying to be as close to the original argument as you are. It will take you either to the successor or the predecessor, depending on which of the two actually has the most bits in common. How does this help to save time? Now, what you can exploit is the fact that if you don't have to walk it all the way to the root, you have not consumed yet your full order log U time. So you can consume the time you have spent saved by not walking all the way upwards by doing something more complex at that particular node. For example, rather than having two sums at this level, you can have h minus g plus one sums, where g is the amount that we count. And you still have complexity on the log u. But you have this complexity or proportional to the height of the tree. The difference being is that rather than having 2 to the power h elements in the universe, you now have h factorial elements. And if I compare h with h factorial, I see that h is now proportional to the logarithm of the universe divided by the logarithm of the logarithm of the universe. And this is an asymptotical improvement, and it applies to the instructions. So we have indeed broken the log u. Very simple idea. So, having had this idea, I walked to the office of John Hopcroft and told him that I had an improvement of what I had found in the book. Now his response was, yes, this is an improvement, and he was a little bit disturbed by the fact that this strange guy from Holland had found it and not one of his students, which he was working with at the time. But he immediately commented, there is room for further improvement because you are doing something very naive. Why not use a more efficient procedure or structure once you have hit on that focal point for what's going on there locally? For example, why not use binary search trees there? Or better, why not use the very structure you are designing in a recursive way? If you would use binary search trees rather than linear search, it immediately will reduce the complexity from order log over log of u to the order squared of the logarithm, which is even further improvement. But if you would work out this recursive ID, you get to order log log u. And then he also told, I just completed this nice paper about with Aho and Ullman about computing lowest common ancestors, and there I'm using this ID of using binary search on levels in a binary tree. Maybe you can exploit that. This is the paper I'm referring to. It's a copy from the Stock 1973 version. engineering since the end of the war, and Mark had been good at Sinclair Paul. By the way, if you go back to my original paper, it will have much more overlap with the content of this paper than anything you will find about funding the Wall Street in the literature. So here is the second approach. This is the approach to find the Wall Street you will find on Wikipedia and all other popularizations. The so-called cluster galaxy decomposition. You take the universe and you divide it in the number of p galaxies, each containing q elements. Consecutive. The idea is that if you want to perform these instructions, you can decompose them in instructions on the cluster level and instructions on the galaxy levels. For example, if you want to insert, if the galaxy containing x as m, you insert x in the galaxy and you have to insert this galaxy in the cluster. In order to evaluate the predecessor, you go to the galaxy of x, try to find the predecessor there, if it's not there or if it happens to be larger than the, if x happens to be the smallest element in its galaxy, you go to the cluster, find the predecessor in the cluster, and then take its largest element. So each of those instructions decomposes into a single similar instruction in the cluster on the galaxy level. If you solve the time complexity recurrence, you see that it means that t of u becomes bounded by twice t of the square root of u plus some constant in case you balance p against q in an optimal way. And that gives you an order log new processing time, which doesn't improve about the binary search tree-based structure. But if you do something additional by storing the minimal element of your universe at the root, you can save work in some circumstances, meaning in fact that if you look at the two recursive calls, one will always be of a special character which can be implemented in constant time if you have sufficiently additional. We can indicate this in these two code fragments. This is the naive approach, but if you look to the more refined perspective, you see that there are these so-called first insertion galaxy, which simply can be stored in an element at the root, and that can be done in constant time. And from this you obtain an improved recurrence, t of u is bounded by t, the time at the square root of u plus some constant, and that gives you the order log u processing bound. So this is a very simple idea, and that's the way you will find it in today's textbooks. But there is some snag. These high-level descriptions don't tell you anything about the murky details of the sort of computations you have to do in order to really perform this. So, for example, given an element x, you must determine the galaxy to which x belongs and its position within the galaxy. And we have to do the converse of this operation. Given a galaxy and some element in that galaxy, we must figure out what is the element in the universe we are actually talking about. Galaxy and position within the galaxy, we basically have to do a multiplication. But multiplication, in multiplicative instructions were disallowed in the machine model which I'm also using, which is the random access machine, with uniform time measure. So you have a nice ID, but it doesn't run on the machine you are using. Actually, the same problem also arises if you are working on binary search on levels, because binary search on levels will tell you to go within the tree to navigate k-steps upwards or k-steps downwards. And if you take the standard indexing of nodes in the binary tree where you place one at the root. And if you have an element with index z, then it's two sums f and well, index has 2z and 2z plus 1, then moving up and down will amount to multiplication and division by powers of 2. But multiplication was not allowed. Now, what is this problem about the machine? We are using the random access machine with uniform time measure. There is also an alternative time measure which is more fair because it keeps in mind the size of the arguments you are manipulating, and that's the logarithmic time measure. This is from the Eyal-Opkoff-Ullman book, the list of instructions available for the random access machine. Actually, you will see that the multiplicative instructions are there, so there is no reason at all if you read the book to distrust them. And then you're left the specification of the logarithmic time measure. Uniform time measure doesn't require such a table because it's just each one time unit for an instruction. Now, why are people making a fuss about these multiplicative instructions? Several reasons. The time we are talking about, 74, it still was experienced that multiplicative instructions in hardware were far more expensive than the additive ones. That's what the computer architecture will desire, will tell you. A more fundamental reason is that people wanted to have a uniform complexity theory, and it means, in practice, that if you have various machine models, they are all equivalent up to polynomial time, overhead, and constant factor overhead in space. That's the requirement for two machine models to give rise to the same fundamental complexity classes: log space, P, NP, P space, X time, and all those animals you know about. In order for them to be properly defined, these machine models all must be equivalent. And people simply didn't see a way to prove that the random access machine with uniform time measure and multiplicative instructions was equivalent to the Turing machine in that sense. No wonder they were not capable of proving it so, because at the very same time I was developing my structure, a group of people in two pairs, Pratt and Stockmar on the one hand, and McManus and Simon on the other hand, were proven to the contrary, that most likely this model is not equivalent to the Turing machine, because in fact it is a model which satisfies the so-called parallel computation thesis, in the sense that polynomial time on this model is equivalent to non-deterministic polynomial time and is equivalent to polynomial space in sequential world, the so-called second class machine model. Fact is that the problem here is provoked by the use and the production and consumption of very large number of exponential sites. But people didn't understand that that was the real core issue, so therefore no multiplicative instructions. Here are the people who did the work, which is Paul Pratt and Mary Stockmeyer. Mary Stockmeyer, too bad to say, is no longer amongst us. Joris Hartmanis and Emma Simon, we have already seen them, these are different pictures from the same period. So, what's the alternative way of working on these things? Binary search on levels. Eventually I implemented it, but it was a lot of work. And what you have to do is to design a very complicated navigational structure within a huge binary tree. So we take the most simple case. The height itself is a power of 2. We have a complete binary tree. The leaves will represent the elements of the universe. We will have a doubly linked list of present element in the universe. And then we need some technical ingredients. One is the so-called rank function. The rank function basically tells you the exponent of the largest power of 2 dividing the height of an element in its tree. If you want to see what a rank function looks like, just take a ruler, take its Anglo-Saxon side in inches, and you will find these nice stripes of shorter and larger length. What you should realize about this function is that it's characteristic. When you have 2 high points, all the points in between are smaller, the heights of those 2 points are different, and there is just 1 unique point with the maximal intermediate height. And within sub-intervals it behaves again in a recursive way like such a rank function. That's the abstract intuition you need. Then you have the so-called canonical subtrees. Of rank D, you have some root which has rank D or higher. The leaves are at the nearest lowest level of rank greater or equal to D, and the height of this tree then is 2 to the power D. If you have a node X of rank D, you can look at the canonical subtree which has D at its root, and you can also look at the canonical subtree of rank D which has X as a leaf. So what you see in this picture, this is the lower canonical subtree, this is the upper canonical subtree. Now I take only the half part to which this node D belongs, and this whole region together is the so-called reach of the node V. Now think back to this picture where you have a huge binary tree with paths being marked above the present elements. What binary search of levels is going to simulate are all those markings, but in a way where the markings are not physically present. The idea is that if within this reach, looking out from this node here, there is such just a single present leaf over here, you will tell that at the root. If not, then somewhere within this reach, a branch point must occur, and you will store information about the presence of this branch point at this node V in order that you can locate it. And then you will have recursive calls on even the top of the bottom part. If you compare this decomposition of the tree with what is happening if you take cluster and galaxy decomposition, on the one hand you will observe that the region covered by this reach more or less corresponds to a sub-cluster or galaxy or a cluster within a galaxy or some recursive structure like that, which you may stumble upon if you apply the recursive cluster galaxy. But this is more concrete. It has this discrimination between the left part and the right part, which is meaningless if you use the cluster and galaxy decomposition. So on the one hand it's more concrete, on the other hand it also means it's more complicated. There is static information in the data structure which basically allows you to navigate from some node V to the closest rank D ancestors for all V. You don't have to go downwards, you only have to go upwards in the navigation procedure. And there is dynamical information which allows you to locate branch points and focal points using binary search levels. The fact that we have this static information means you basically have order log log u pointers at every node. That's bad news, because it tells you that our space, the uniform space measure, is going to be order u times log log u, superlinear space. It's taking me about 3 years to get rid of that. You have to discriminate between so-called present nodes, which are the nodes which correspond to the marked nodes in the naive approach, and the active nodes, the nodes where actually information is being stored. And this distinction is covered by a fundamental invariant in an algorithm. I wasn't trained by Dijkstra, but I still applied more or less this guidelines that you always should develop your algorithms by first stipulating the correct invariants. And the proper invariant here is that the present node is active if there exists a branch point within the interior of the reach of the node. So it should be neither the leaf of that reach nor the root of this reach. But if there is happening something internally, then this node is active and you will find information there. Now, this is a picture which you simply presumably cannot read here. It gives an example for a three-element set in height 16-3 about of a proper representation. These are the fields you need for dynamic information. You have an L min and L max telling you the lowest present and highest present leaf in the left part of the lower canonical subtree of the reach. R min and R max tell the same thing about the right hand side in the reach. And UB is an indicator which tells you whether a branch point occurs in the upper canonical subtree of the reach. All very complicated. I've copied here a code fragment from the Pascal implementation, which you cannot read, but the important thing is that I indicated here the two recursive calls, and you can see that they are nicely separated in an if-then-else condition. So you will only call one of them, not both. And this is a picture from the old paper showing the thin action for the journals. Second element. You see something interesting happening in terms of the middle level. You see that these two pots still separated here, and you have to do something on the top level. You see that the two pots have merged by the movement, so a branch point will occur in the middle. That's in a nutshell the whole intuition between the primary search on levels. Want to see more? Again, read the 77 paper. It has all the details, including the Pascal curve. So, how was this thing developed? This is the original Cornell report from December 74. It has the binary search and level approach, but if you look at the way the instructions were implemented, they were completely based on navigating this binary tree. So this is what the fundamental instructions were. Locate the lowest present vertex on the path of the non-present leaf to the root. Insert the non-present leaf in the data structure. Locate the lowest branch point on the path from the present leaf to the root, and delete the present leaf and make it present in the data structure. Nothing of the functionality is visible here, but you can use these fundamental instructions for doing everything. The second time I wrote on it was for the occasion of a talk I gave in February 75 at IRIA in Versailles. The paper appeared about half a year later. Again, I had this primary search level approach. that you see the human soul. You look to the instructions, or at least insert and delete and update the functional link. But all of the technologies has changed, except for the fact that I now realize the name of this important ingredient. Then, I didn't like the way I had programmed my algorithms. In particular, I didn't have a recursive version of the delete instruction. So I assigned the job to a number of students, and they produced a very nice Pascal program implementing all the instructions. Still based on my binary search and level approach, but now all the operations are functional. You simply see the instruction repertoire. So they build a structure on that emulator for those instructions. And they repair the number of errors in my earlier algorithms and obtain the recursive delete instruction. Here are my two students. This is Rob Kaas, who became later a professor in economical science, mathematical science at my university. Erik Zijlstam graduated about 7 years later and went to Foxborough and I have lost contact with him. The thing was submitted to the Foundation for Computer Science Conference in Berkeley in 1975. I presented the paper there. This is the Fox paper. Still based on the binary search on level approach. As an aside, I mentioned the alternative, of course, the galaxy decomposition, but I don't work out the details. And this paper is based on the operational implementation by Kaas and Zijlstra. It has some of the code fragments. So when I wrote a journal version, I decided to include the complete Pascal code, and I also added Kaas and Zijlstra as co-authors. Which, as Mr. Kaas told me, has caused an incredible frequency to obtain emails where people asking about the structure and yet the slides are not how to answer. Such things happen. Then, about 2 years later, 1.5 year, I finally found a way of getting rid of the supervision storage requirements. Here's a simple idea, apply crystal galaxy decomposition once again with the higher data structure. So this is my stratified tree, it achieves more workload and time complexity at space and workload n, but here I use something which is linear space and linear time. And if I now take proper values here for n and n, particularly if I make n equal to log of n, then I'm in good shape. I have linear space and linear still part of log of n time. Very simple idea. The bad thing was that I didn't patent the idea of having these sort of hybrid structures, since they become in the next year very popular in the work of my colleagues in Jan van Leeuwen and Mark Overmars in design all sorts of nice dynamic data structures. But this is one of the original applications that I did. I'm not sure whether I really invented it myself or absorbed it in interaction with Jan van Leeuwen, since we were having joint seminars on complexity theory and data structures around the period. But it's one of the early applications. Then, around the same period, Knut wrote his famous classroom notes where he worked out his recursive cluster galaxy composition idea. This is the first page of his original note. He specifically looks at verified cases also. Count the number of computer boards you need on IBM 360. And there is another thing in this paper, that by the way I received it. Internet didn't exist at the time. And this is what Don Knuth was looking like. It also has this famous quote you see here. Beware of birds in the rough coat. I don't have any proof it's correct, not trying. By way of illustration, it's the same quotation on a slide of a conference pictured it in 2004. It was a presentation by this guy, Alan Kay, at Uppsala 2004 in Vancouver. How much time do we have?
Yeah, so like the same 5 minutes.
Okay, let's see how far I get. I will skip those two papers. These are two later papers from 77, 78, where I'm talking about recursive decomposition approach. Now, a fundamental question. Is the recursive decomposition in clustering graphs somehow equivalent to the binary search on that? The answer is they are algorithmically different. And the cause is this left-right distinction, which is meaningless in the recursive cluster gap city composition. Because it's more concrete and more specific, it allows you in some specific cases, in particular when the focal point is located at the root of a canonical subtree where you are present, to terminate recursion, whereas in the recursive decomposition you will have to recurse them all the way to the bottom. So in that sense it's different. Let's tell you a little bit about the impact. This is what you see if you ask for Fernando Bolas in Google Scholar. I intend to proudly pronounce that I have the top two positions. But that's no longer true. These two top positions have been stolen from me from my another Fernando Bolas, who happens to be my brother, and he works in medicine. Computer science never can compete with medicine if you're counting on quotations. But I still have the number three and four positions with 551 and 408 citations. No way to inspect them all. If you think about applications, you always are facing a situation that in order to be meaningful, you need a size of the set to be manipulated, which is large, relatively large compared to the size of the universe. Otherwise, using a structure doesn't make sense. But if in order to become meaningful, the universe has to be quite large, otherwise a lot of you will be much larger than lock you, and then the space available in the machine becomes important. At this stage we have done nothing about the space conception. So even if you have the improvement, it consumes a little space. So that severely restricts the number of areas where you can have meaningful applications with string manipulations, computational geometry and scheduling the rare applications. This is actually the oldest application known to me. It's a string manipulation theory from Bund and Szymanski. If you read the abstract, you cannot read it, you will won't find anything about the log or n complexity. It's only the final page where you add it. Second, purely theoretical results which will give them an improvement. The other interesting thing is if you look at the submission date, May 75, at that time the only accessible publication was the original format. It's a dynamic programming method in string manipulation. Concerning improvement, the oldest improvement known is from Goldwyn Johnson. That's Goldwyn Johnson. He observed that you actually can improve the operating time from our local view to our local D, where D is the distance to the neighbor. The funny thing about this improvement is that you really have to use the binary search level solution, because it doesn't work in the current proposition. Nailhorn and Nail together after a preliminary work by people like Miller and others solved basically the problem about the space conception by combining the simple stratified field ID with dynamic hashing in the style of Fredman, Thomas and Samarin. Now, I knew the work of Fredman, Thomas and Samarin. I actually have used it in one of my papers from 84. But by the time I was no longer working in the stratified field, so the idea of applying it to my own results never came up with me. So that's the reason I chose to put my work in the so I don't have to get yours anywhere to show. Lower bounds, same people, together with Holmes Alt, proof the lower bound for the law of U in the so-called point bound, which is nice because my original structure was developed in a binary structure. Really interesting lower bounds have been put by Thorik and your late colleague. My Trashko, how do you pronounce his name?
Trashko.
Trashko.
Yes,
I know. There's a very nice obituary in second English earlier this year. So, reference. This, now, you cannot read it, because this is a very complicated lower bound, maximum upper bound. And the good news is that it shows that over part of the relevant parameter space on the structure is still optimal, but the machine model is restricted. Whereas I was prohibited from using multiplicative construction of a very innocent character, just bit shift basically. These people are working in a world where you have access to full AC0 instructions on board sizes which are much larger than the size of your logarithm, the size of your universe. So it's an entirely different world. They're using many IDs of parallel logarithm designs. I've completely not kept up with it. So it's virtually impossible for me to read this paper. I got stuck at the very first level. Textbook versions. The oldest one I know is has appeared in the book by called Nailhorn, which was the first book in the so-called ERTCS monogram series. If you look at it, it's the first galaxy composition. From the same year, there is this book by Gaston Blanet. And this may be actually the first book of the name and laws as affiliated to the tree. Knut also uses my name classroom, but he just described connects it to the strategy of matter. He doesn't connect it to the tree. I'm not sure whether this is the creator of the name of the world's tree, but it must have happened somewhere during that period. Again, we cannot bring the code fragment. This is a more recent textbook by Carl Leisers and Rivers Stein. It's actually the third edition of the textbook, but what they write in the back cover is that they have added two new chapters, one about the world streets. So I think this is the first time I got mentioned in the back cover of the book. If you look at the code fragment, it's just as the galaxy is composition. Be it that they have something very strange. Presumably these authors don't know their astronomy, because they assign a name cluster to what I call a galaxy, and what I call a cluster, they call a sun, very confused. They don't know what they do. And this is Wikipedia, it has basically the same product as you find in the various tons of layers and columns. Conclusion. I hope you have convinced you that there are basically two versions of the stratified tree. My research is working because of the housing composition. But these two versions actually are different. That the machine model-based constraints are forced maybe to work more difficult of those two approaches. That Don Knuth actually is the first publisher who has written anything accessible to about the alternative version. Actually, one of the tasks I completed before while finishing this process, that I've taken my copy from this letter of Knuth and my letter going back in Carlsberg Road, and I've placed it on my website. So now it's accessible. You'll find the reference in the papers in proceedings. Today you only see the recursive decomposition version, I don't think anybody alive realizes that this is a different version. The issue with multiplicative constructions today is Spanish. Most people simply go now they can use multiplication and division, so if you don't abuse them by the Spanish large partners. And the final message, you are a number of brilliant young guys in the developing side. Maybe I was feeling similar compared to US-based computer science and famed to Cornell in 74. See, just by interacting with development fields, you can become very fast, very productive. So that's the chance of you grab something which is under development and don't feel disturbed, you don't understand the field completely, because the very fact that you don't know the exact rules makes it possible to do what I did in 74 as observed by Kurt Mirborn in the talk he gave at my valedictory symposium. I broke through the rules.
So thank you, Peter, for this very deep and insightful talk. So are there any questions? So I have one question. Actually, I have two, but so the first one is in the envelope that Phil sent you. So was there any money like the one that grew government?
No, to the contrary, he claimed the price I had offered in the presentation of my paper at the Fox conference for a correctness proof. And I answered him that he didn't allow, because he didn't provide a correctness proof, he made it superfluous. But then I sent him one of my traditional presents at the time, which is a Dutch mint tile.
Okay, so thank you. Questions?
What's the other question?
My other question is actually related to pointer machines, right? So pointers or linking automata, but not. Right? So why actually you were talking about pointer machines?
Hello.
The reason was that even if I would use this binary tree, as I described on the paper, I still had to do the navigation steps, which is the jumping K levels upwards or K levels down. And I would have needed multiplicative instructions for doing so. So that was the second round of interaction with John Walker at a later stage. He still pointed out that I was using illegal things, and then I decided I should pre-evaluate all the navigation steps in advance, and that created a superlinear space. eventually, we found out that the spree computation also could do that being performed in the form of table lookups. And if you read the front paper and the proceedings, you will see that there is actually a code fragment listed there, how you can pre-compute the tables of all these splits and concatenation operations you need in the recursive decomposition approach without using any multiplication. It's just a nested loop construction. And the full code fragment is basically there. It's a trivial piece of program. There is just a minor catch, don't use two-dimensional arrays, because two-dimensional array indexing formula uses multiplication, and that's not a lot. But a row of row instruction, if you have it in the model 60, is trivial. So.
Questions?
So, because we recognize anything of it.
Okay, so then let's just thank Peter for coming here.